So let's begin. This is lecture 40. Okay, so the last thing we were saying was basically OFTM and how the transmitter can be implemented efficiently with an FFT. So how does the block look? So I'm going to draw a block diagram of how the whole thing would look. So you have a series of symbols, I mean a sequence of symbols coming in. Okay, so you have NC, say NC symbols. Okay, some smaller number. Okay, you have to zero pad it, top and the bottom. Okay, so that's what you do. And evaluate an endpoint IFFT. Okay, so you have, so I'll call it S1K. S2K, so on till say Sn minus delta k, right? Here you have zeros, and here you have zeros being input as well. Okay, so in total you have an endpoint FFT that's evaluated. After you evaluate the endpoint FFT, simply get x tilde 0, x tilde 1, I'll call it x tilde n minus 1. Okay, so this is the result of the endpoint IFFT. Okay, so then you do a parallel to serial conversion. That's what's called the next block, P stroke S. Okay, to get your x tilde k. Okay, remember you wanted to generate an x tilde of t. How are we going to generate it? We're going to sample the x tilde of t and then send that samples through a D2A converter to get our required analog signal. That's what we were going to do. And when we tried to sample the x tilde of t, we found that those samples were nothing but the IFFT of the symbols that we wanted to transmit. Okay, so you do the IFFT first and then convert them into a series of samples. The timing is important. Okay, so this needs to be shifted out at what? T by n. Okay, so clock will be T by n. You shift them out at T by n. Then this goes through. Okay, and then what do? You have a D2A converter. Okay, so the ideal D2A converter is going to do a sync interpolation. Right, you're going to multiply each sample with a sync located at that point, right? You do that. Okay, so in practice many D2A converters would do sample and hold and then do a low pass filter. The low pass filter is also a sync, right? So that's also the same thing, so some version of that. So in effect you can assume that sync interpolation is being done. It's not a very bad approximation. Okay, so that's being done, and then what do? You get your x tilde of t, you do up conversion. Okay, so you up convert and then you transmit. Take the real part, you're going to get your signal, your pass band transmit signal. Okay, so this is how a transmitter looks when you're doing OFTM. Okay, so one of the points I want to make, this is basically a block modulation scheme. That's the first point I want to make. Okay, so the overall pulse at baseband occupies how much time? A total of t seconds, right? Right? In t seconds, you're sending n symbols, but not really n. It says n minus delta because of the minor zero problem. But anyway, let's think of it as n symbols. You're sending n symbols in capital T seconds with a very, very long time domain waveform. Okay? The waveform corresponding to each signal, okay, right? What actually happens is there are several waveforms corresponding to each signal. They are all added together, right? Remember, that's what's happening roughly in the multi-carrier waveform. Each signal, each symbol gets multiplied by a e power j 2 pi n delta f t, okay, and then with the rectangular pulse shape that lasts from 0 to t. Okay, so the signal corresponding to each symbol will last the entire T seconds, and all of these guys are being added. Okay, so it's a block modulation scheme, and it works in that fashion. Okay, so if you want to relate it to serial PAM, okay, if you want to relate it to serial PAM and see an equivalent system, the serial PAM will have to work at a symbol rate of t by m. Okay, well, n by t. Symbol rate would be n by t. Symbol period, every the symbol would come out every n by t. But you would have only one transmit filter for all of them. Here you have different transmit filters for each of these cases. Okay, is that clear? So that's the way it works. So one of the advantages is, since the signal corresponding to each symbol now lasts for a long time, right? Time impulsive noise or time fading will be not that serious a problem in OFDM, in the block modulation scheme. You're letting the signal corresponding to each symbol last for a really long time. In serial PIM, you don't do that, right? Maybe the signal corresponding to one symbol will last for 3 or 4 symbols. Okay, and if it's t by n, then it's only 3t by n or 4t by n. It's not the entire t. Okay, here the signal corresponding to each symbol is lasting for such a long time. So if you have deep fades or if you have time impulsive noise, you're a little bit immune. Okay, so that's an advantage in this block modulation scheme. Might happen. So it happens actually in several cases. In telephone lines it happens, because there might be something else happening nearby, right? So these telephone cables are not kept in isolation from anything else. They might be next to some power circuitry which is being turned on all of a sudden. That might give you an impulsive noise in time. So these things happen in telephone circuitry a lot. In wireless, the deep fading is one thing. So once in a while in wireless communications, because of the way the sinusoids are adding, you'll suddenly have a big drop in amplitude. It will recover fast, but you will have a drop in amplitude. So for those kind of things, OFDM is suited. Okay. So this is the transmitter. Okay. So the transmitter is easy enough, but you have to be able to demodulate on the other side, right? It's not clear how we are going to extract all the symbols. In the FDM case, all of the symbols were separated in frequency nicely with the guard band. So we could put a bank of bandpass filters and separate them out. Okay, the signals corresponding to each symbol were in fact orthogonal. Okay, they were not overlapping in frequency. If the frequencies don't overlap, then in time domain also they are orthogonal, right? When you do the dot product, you can do the dot product in the frequency domain also. That will go to zero. It's very clear that they are orthogonal. Okay, it turns out even in OFDM, the signals are orthogonal. Okay, but they're not distinct in frequency. Okay, so they overlap significantly in the frequency domain, but still the two signals are orthogonal. Okay, so that's the next point, which is slightly not very obvious. We'll prove it as we go along. Okay, the signals are orthogonal. Okay, so that's why people loosely call it orthogonal frequency division multiplexing. So it's actually not frequency division multiplexing, but it's still orthogonal, so you can separate it. Okay, so that's what we're going to see next. We're going to see how to build a demodulator for this. Okay, so if you go back to first principles, how do you build demodulators? What's the ideal way of building a receiver? You look at the set of all possible signals, build a signal space. How do you build a signal space? You do Gram-Schmidt orthonormalization or figure out a orthonormal basis for your signal space, which will span your signal space. And then what should you do? Correlate with the basis, and then look at the answers, results of the correlation, and slice the results of the correlation to get your transmitted signal. Okay, so that's the ready-made procedure, and that procedure will not change. Whatever modulation you do, it's the exact same procedure that you have to follow. Okay, so the first thing to figure out is, what is the signal space? Okay, so for that, we'll look at the signal here. Okay, if I have a sequence of symbols that I'm sending, I'm going to look at the signal here as the signal corresponding to that set of symbols. Then I list out all possible signals and then see which is a basis for my signal space, and then go on. And okay, so you'll see there'll be a very simple basis because the signals will be orthogonal. Okay, all right. So that's what we're going to do now. So I'm going to call this signal x tilde of t. Okay, so after the D to A, x tilde of t is going to be Okay, I'm going to assume ideal sync interpolation in my D2A. There might be some approximation, yeah, but anyway, it's a good enough assumption when you're trying to study. Okay, it's going to be x tilde of t, n equals 0 to n minus 1. The samples are going to be multiplied by shifted sinks. So the sinks have to be shifted by t by n. And what is this p of t? Okay, so in its normalized form, it will look like this. Sine pi n t by t divided by pi t. Okay, so if you're wondering what is this, if you do a Fourier transform here, you will get a rect between minus n by t, n by t. Okay, so that's it's the Fourier transform of that to get a sync interpolation. Okay, so this is what you hope to do in an ideal D2A. It will give you a very accurate, complete interpolation for your samples to get your x tilde of t. Okay? Alright. So what we're going to do now, see, this is x tilde of t in terms of x tilde of n. I want to find the signal corresponding to a sequence of symbols that I have, not necessarily something in the middle that I generated. So I have to basically substitute x tilde of n in terms of s. Okay, if I do that, then I'll get my symbols corresponding to the signal corresponding to the input symbols that I had. Okay, so that's what I'm going to substitute. When I do that, x tilde of t becomes summation n equals 0 to n minus 1. Remember, x tilde of n is the inverse Fourier transform of or DFT or FFT or whatever you want to call it, SLK e power j 2 pi ln by n times p of t minus nt by n. Okay, so this is the x tilde of t. Right? I'm sorry? SN, na? I think I might have, yeah, I know L is the running variable, but I think in the way I drew the block diagram, I'm thinking of the running variable being in the subscript for S. Okay, it's just the way I wrote it. If you want, you can think of that as SL also. It's okay. It's also fine. You can replace this with S of L. Okay, if you're confused. If that's clearer to you, that's S of L. It's fine. The reason why I wanted to bring in K is, people usually think of an OFDM, what's called an OFDM symbol. What's an OFDM symbol? All of them together becomes an OFDM symbol. Okay, so because one signal corresponds to one OFDM symbol, which is one block symbol, right? So that's why this K can index that OFDM symbol. That's why I have the K. But I think this K is completely irrelevant for us. We are not going to look at multiple OFDM symbols. We will look at it, but mostly only one OFDM symbol we will look at. Anyway, it's also fine. So now I'm going to interchange the order of summation to pull my symbols out. I want to have finally a form where my symbols are multiplying. So let me just use SL. Okay, summation n equals 0 to n minus 1. Okay, it's also customary to put a 1 by root n if you want for the IFFT. Okay, why do you want to put the 1 by root n? To make sure you don't add energy when you do IFFT, right? So when you do 1 by root n, it becomes a proper unitary transformation. Nothing else will happen to it. Okay, so but anyway, that's just a constant. I might ignore it, I might have it, but maybe we'll keep it later. Okay, once again, that's important only for the exam, so keep that in mind. E power j 2 pi ln divided by n p t minus n t by n. Okay, there you go. So my signal that's actually being transmitted, the baseband signal that's actually being transmitted, is a linear combination of several sums of sinks, right? Sums of shifted sinks, or well, maybe something like that. Okay, the multiplication is by some exponential, and finally the linear combination is with the symbols itself, S of L, right? These are my signals. How many possible signals will I have? Yeah, so size of x power n, and if you have different size of x for each of these things, product of the size of the alphabets, right? The only thing that's varying here is the symbol. The symbol is different, but what is showing up inside here is the same, whatever your symbol is. Okay, so these things will change. So clearly, this is my signal space. These things form my signal space. I have to find an orthogonal basis for my signal space, and it turns out magically enough that these guys for different L form a orthonormal set of signals. Okay, so once that comes, you see immediately directly you can identify what your orthonormal basis is for the signal space, and you know what your constellation is. You can go ahead and do your reception very easily. Okay, so that's what I'm going to write down. So I'm going to call this as, what am I going to call it? I'm going to call it as GLT. Okay, so this is G subscript L T. Okay, so maybe I'll put GL tilde. Okay, just to be sure about that. This is going to be GL tilde T. Okay, so that is my that signal. Okay, and my claim is, okay, so this is okay, right? So my claim is this set GL tilde of T for L running from 0 to n minus 1 is orthonormal. Okay, you can prove this. It's not too difficult. We will not prove it in this class. You can easily prove it. Okay, so it's not a problem. Okay, so once that becomes an orthonormal basis, your orthonormal set of signals, you can make that the basis of your signal space. So this becomes the basis of signal space. So that directly tells you how to do the reception. Okay, so you'll have to correlate with each of these GL tildes of T, then look at the result of the correlation and then slice it. Okay. So if you go back and look at how the signal is being formed, S of L multiplies GL tilde of T. So if you correlate with GL tilde of T, well, GL tilde of T, what will happen? Only S of L will remain, right? That correspond, okay, so I should be careful, say GJ tilde of T, only that S of J will remain, everything else will disappear, okay? So the slicing you can do independently for each channel. You don't have to do a common slicing between all of them because of the way the signals are formed, okay? It's orthogonal, each symbol is multiplying a orthogonal signal. So you simply do a correlation, then whatever result you get, you slice for that channel alone separately. It doesn't have to relate to the other channel. So that's another nice thing. Okay, even though you're doing a block modulation together, at the slicer, you don't have to do a block slicing. You just do individual slicing. Okay, so that's a nice thing about OFDM again. Okay, so that's one thing that's being suggested. Okay, so but I want to draw a few plots of this GL tilde of T just to give you an idea of how these things will look. Okay. Okay, it might seem a little bit complicated when you look at GL tilde of T. So, if you see GL tilde of T, the way we wrote it down, how did I write it down? Okay, so it's going to be summation e power j n equals 0 to n minus 1 j 2 pi l n by n. There might be a normalization p of t minus n t by, well, n t by n, sorry, n t by n. Okay. So it looks and seems like a complicated picture to draw, right? I mean, first of all, how can you draw it? This is actually a complex valued signal. Okay, you can't draw it very directly. So you'll have to draw the real part and the imaginary part. But you expect the real part and imaginary part to be quite related. It'll be kind of sinusoidal something. Okay. So how do you see that this is a sinusoid? Basically, you can define another signal which is called, which I'll call GLT, which is say e power j 2 pi LT by T, okay, and then you do a rectangular window between 0 and capital T, okay, U of T is the unit step, so U of T minus U of T minus T is the rectangular window from 0 to T. You define this as GLT, okay, you can plot the real and imaginary part of this. What is the real and imaginary part of this? Sine and cos, okay, right? Cos and sine. So you can easily draw it. Okay. How do you obtain GL tilde of T from GL of T? Okay. You sample GL of T at T by N and then do a sync interpolation, put it through a D to A. Okay, so you sample it at T by N and put it through a D to A, you get that thing. Okay, so if you are sampling and you are interpolating, you should get back the original picture, right? Roughly, at least between 0 and T, you should get definitely, if you do proper sync interpolation, you should get back the overall thing. Okay, so that's what you will get. Between 0 and T, you will get a sinusoid, sinusoid for the imaginary part and a cosine for the real part. Okay, well, phase pi by 2 shifted sinusoid, but it will also extend beyond 0 and after T. Why? So that's what the sync interpolation will do. Okay, if you want to get the proper sync interpolation, you will get some extension before 0 and after T. Okay, but in this signal, when you do OFDM transmission, you are not going to send before 0 and after T. So you will truncate that. Okay, so that's a bit of a suboptimality there as well. Okay, is that clear? Okay, so think about it. If you did not truncate, you will be limited in bandwidth. In bandwidth, you will be between n by 2t and minus n by 2t. But because of your truncation, you will spill over beyond n by 2t and minus n by 2t, which is adjusted with your zeros in the IFFT. Okay, so everything will work out properly. But you have to remember that the sync interpolation is a bit of a non-ideality here, and the way this plot will look also should be clear to you. Between 0 and T, this will be a sinusoid. Okay, so that's how the plot will look. Sinusoids of different frequencies depending on L. If L is 0, it will be constant. If L is 1, it will be a sinusoid. If it is 2, it will be one more higher frequency sinusoid. So basically, sinusoids of different frequencies are your is your GL tilde of T. Okay, that's why they become orthogonal as well. Sinusoids of multiple frequencies, they become orthogonal. Okay, so pretty much the same reason will work out. Okay, so this is an important thing to keep in mind. This signal, even though it's an ideal version of that signal, it's closely related to the actual transmit signal. Okay, so all these things are some nice points to keep in mind. Okay, so let's move on along and see the receiver picture. Okay, so the first assumption we'll make is that the channel is benign. Okay, so we'll say channel adds noise, but it doesn't do any filtering. Okay, so it's delta. Okay, channel is a delta of T, and then you add noise to it. So that's the first receiver we'll build. That's what we did even for PAM. Okay, so serial PAM, first we assume there is no linear distortion in the channel, and then we built a receiver, and then we'll see what happens when there is ISI or channel does something. Okay, so that's the first receiver we'll build. So this is the receiver for no ISI case. In the no ISI case, right, even at the receiving point, all your signals, the same orthonormality will hold. Okay, because what you receive will be the same transmit signal plus noise, and your signal space is still the same. It's not been changed by any convolution. Okay, it's still the same. So the same orthonormality holds. So the optimal receiver is to do correlation with GL tilde of T. Okay, so I should be careful here. It's GL tilde conjugate. Okay, so it's a dot product. So you have to do correlation with that. Okay, so previously we never dealt with a complex signal. We always had real signals, so these things didn't matter. But here you have to put a conjugate carefully. Okay, so let's do the correlation. So correlation is going to be integral minus infinity to infinity R of T, which is my received signal. Remember, R of T is the baseband received signal, X tilde of T plus N of T. N of T is once again the baseband noise. Okay, so that's my model. R of T, GL star of T, DT. Okay, this is the Lth correlator. I'm going to call the result of the Lth correlator as Y tilde L. Okay, so you have to do this for what L? All of them. Okay, 0 to N minus 1. So now let's substitute this, and you'll see a nice, a nice simplification happens. Okay, summation L equals 0 to N minus 1. You'll have e power minus j 2 pi NL by N P of T minus L T by N. Did you get that right? No. It is constant. n na okay okay so what should I do here n is down below right says okay well it's all the same but anyway we'll do it directly all I have to do is change l to n there right it's okay this is fine no this is okay okay so I do this and then I do a dt okay so now once again we'll interchange the summation and the integration and see if something nice comes out you see summation n equals 0 to n minus 1 e power minus j 2 pi n l by n times what integral minus infinity to infinity r of t p of t minus n t by n dt okay all right so even this correlation with gl star of t is going to simplify okay so how is it going to simplify you don't have to do this operation for every l repeatedly why because that operation is independent of l okay you do it only for only once to the r of t and then you do something with respect to l inside okay so what is that something so this I'm going to call rn okay because this depends only on r it doesn't depend on anything else so it's rn okay what is this rn if you look at it very closely it's nothing but filtering of r of t with a sink okay a shifted sink well but still it's just a filtering of r of t with the sink and sampled at t by n am I right so you can write it differently in a different way as filtering of r of t with a sink sampled at t by n so what is filtering with a sink same as a low pass filter so if you take r of t put an anti-aliasing low pass filter between minus n by 2t and n by 2t and then sample it at n by t frequency you get r of n okay so how do you get r of n r of n is obtained from r of t by doing a low pass filter which is an anti-aliasing low pass filter between minus n by 2t and n by 2t and then you sample at what t by n okay so n t by n you get rn okay so this is how you obtain rn okay so once I have rn how am I going to write my y tilde of l it's going to be summation n equals 0 no and n equals 0 to n minus 1 am I right yeah r of n e power minus j 2 pi n l by n what is this this is the FFT of the sequence rn from evaluated at l okay so this is nothing but the FFT of r 0 through r n minus 1 at l okay so that's it so now the receiver the entire receiver becomes much more simpler first you do a low pass filter followed by a sampling at t by n and then what you do a serial to parallel conversion okay so you do a serial to parallel conversion to collect r of 0 r of 1 so until r n minus 1 and then what do you do n point FFT once you do an n point FFT what will you get your y tilde of 0 y tilde of 1 y tilde of n minus 1 now what can you do okay a block slicing is not necessary because we saw once you correlate only the subcarrier remains the signal corresponding to subcarrier remains so you can do independent slicing to obtain each of your received signals okay so behind this ugly looking picture is a very neat simplification of the signal processing involved all you're doing is low pass filtering followed by sampling then putting it together, run it through an FFT, you get your blocks to slice. Okay. So even though OFDM looks like a very complicated modulation scheme, much more complicated than serial PAM, the signal processing involved involves pretty much the same thing as serial PAM except for the IFFT and FFT blocks. Okay, which seem like extra added things which are not really necessary, right? If you're doing serial PAM on a benign channel, why do you want to do an FFT and IFFT? Okay, but it turns out when you have a ISA channel, it gives you several possibilities of having suboptimal equalizers with very, very cheap receivers. The cheap receivers as in assuming FFT is easy to implement. Okay, very cheap receivers are possible even for ISI channels. Okay, so that's the great thing about OFDM. Okay, so if you do serial PAM, you have to pay for the equalization you're doing. Okay, something extra you have to pay. In OFDM, there are some very many great simplifications. Okay, any questions on this? So maybe I should, I'm going to draw next the overall picture once again, but in the discrete time model. So far we've been thinking of continuous time and all these things, but eventually, ultimately, we want to throw away the D to A's and the A to D's, right? And then only draw a picture that involves discrete time signals. Okay, so that's what I'm going to draw finally. Okay, so the final discrete time picture for the no ISI case. It's going to look like this. Okay, so you have symbols coming in at what? Okay, so whatever range. Okay, so this is a vector of signals which are coming in at 1 by t. Okay, so I do a serial to parallel conversion. Okay, I should do a large serial to parallel conversion block. To obtain my S of 0, S of 1, so on till S of n minus 1. Remember this, this is a vector, this is, these are the components of the vector SK. So if K denotes the kth OFDM symbol. Okay, so as the it's a vector of several symbols. Okay, K changes, the next OFDM symbol comes in. Okay, I'm going to first run it through an IFFT. Okay, then what happens? I have a parallel to serial conversion. I get my what I called as x tilde n. Okay, so this is going to go through a channel which is once again can be made discrete time equivalent. Okay, well, some noise, and I get my Rn. Okay, so remember the channel is not there because it's a delta channel. That's my assumption. Okay, so then you do a serial to parallel conversion. Okay, basically put R0 through Rn minus 1, and then you do a FFT. You get okay, so I'm going to run out of room, let me try. You get your decision variables y tilde of 0, y tilde of n minus 1. Okay, then all you have to do is put it through a parallel to serial converter and you slice. Okay, so you get your sequence out. Yeah. If you have multiple slices, then it's okay. If you want to have one slicer, I can fill everything. Depends on how you build it. When many of these serial parallel and all, I'm just putting it there for convenience, just to take one input and make it multiple inputs, multiple outputs, right? So that's all. Okay, so this is how a discrete time OFDM looks. In comparison, serial PAM, okay, serial PAM would have a transmit filter, would have basically all of the signals going through without any FFT and all that to noise. But the signals would come in at, you would imagine them coming in at n by t as opposed to 1 by t. Okay, so it's the same thing, but it's being done differently. Okay. So this is OFDM, and the advantage, just like I mentioned, gives you several advantages. Okay, so what I'm going to write next is a matrix model for exactly what's happening here, because that matrix model is very useful when we go along and consider ISI. Right now there's no ISI, so it seems very simple. The next thing I'm going to introduce is, I'm going to put x tilde of n through a channel, a discrete time equivalent channel, baseband channel. Okay, once it goes through that, then all these assumptions will not be true anymore. Okay, your transmit signal will not be, the orthogonality assumption you made will not be orthogonal anymore. It's getting convolved with the h of t, and your signal space would have changed. Okay, even if it is orthogonal, you don't know if it will span your signal space. You don't know anything about your signal space. So only thing you can do is suboptimal reception. Okay, so there, this matrix picture will help. Okay, so this is the matrix equivalent of what I'm going to write. I'm going to write, basically, at the transmitter, the x tilde of zeros, the x tilde 0 to x tilde of n minus 1 is basically obtained as a matrix, which is an FFT matrix, okay, which I'll call FFTN. Okay, what's the ijth entry of the FFT matrix? Well, I don't know, maybe ikth entry of the FFT matrix, e power minus j 2 pi, right? J whatever ik divided by capital N. Okay, so it's in fact an IFFT. So I'll write it as FFT inverse. Okay, so you can imagine that this FFT matrix is normalized by 1 by root N if you want a unitary behavior. Okay, so this multiplies S of 0, S of 1 through S of N minus 1. Okay, the initial and final symbols will have to be 0 to make sure things fit, but it's okay to put that. Okay, so this is your, this we might call as the vector x, this we might call as the vector s. Okay, so the vector r, which I'm going to call r0 to rn minus 1 s. Okay, that's going to be the vector r. See, that's going to be what? Basically FFT n inverse s plus a noise vector. Okay, so this matrix has a lot of good properties. One of them is that it is unitary. Okay, so basically it's rotation. Okay, angles are not changed, magnitudes are not changed, it's a pure rotation in a very large dimension. Okay, it's a unitary matrix. Okay, whatever n you choose, it's unitary. Okay, so it turns out in such a problem, optimal way of decoding s is to simply multiply throughout by FFTN. Okay, so it's very clear, it's unitary. So if you multiply n by a unitary matrix, what will happen? Nothing will happen. Okay, no statistics will change, it will remain exactly the same. There will be no noise enhancement, nothing will really happen. But if this matrix were not unitary, then you're in trouble. If you do that, noise will get enhanced very severely. Okay, so this is a similar model. So when you receive, it's okay to simply multiply by FFTN, R gives you S plus FFTN times noise, and this has the same statistics as N. Okay, basically there's no noise enhancement. So simply do FFT and then you do the same slicer, it works. Okay, so that's the discrete time picture. Okay. So now we're going to look at a case where there is ISI. Okay, so ISI and OFDM. Okay, we'll look at only the discrete time model because that's simpler, that is simple. But if you want to go back to the continuous time model, imagine a continuous time filter, then it is going through a same A to D in the sampler. Okay, so eventually between the x tilde of n and r of n, you will always have a discrete time picture. That's the discrete time picture that I'm having here. Okay, so I'm going to say my x tilde of n is going through a channel which is h of n, to which noise gets added, and then you receive Rn. Okay, so what is h of n? I'm going to say h of n is basically h of 0, h of 1, so on till h l minus 1. Okay, so it's an L tap channel. Okay, L or L minus 1 or anything you want to call it. Okay, so basically, finally, you can write R of n is x tilde of n convolved with h of n plus, well, I have to write, I'll simply write noise. Okay. Is it okay? So this is what is your ISI model. So in the ISI model, your GL tilde of T will change. It will not be spanning the signal space anymore at the receiver. Okay, one, because the receiver got convolved with some H of T, so some channel, we don't know what the channel is. So we cannot hope to do optimal reception at the receiver, unless you figure out what the signal space is. Okay, so that's not what the main advantage of OFDM is. It turns out, within there is a suboptimal receiver, suboptimal way of dealing with ISI, which is really, really cheap for the receiver. Okay, so you have a very cheap and easy way of dealing with ISI in a suboptimal way, and that's by what's adding what's called a cyclic prefix. Okay. Okay. So what happens in a cyclic prefix is you change your transmission. You don't simply send x tilde of n, you send something more. You incur a penalty in your transmission. Okay, but you send it so that this linear convolution becomes a circular convolution. Okay, so that's the idea. Basic idea behind adding a cyclic prefix is you don't just send your x tilde of n, you send something more. Basically, you repeat a part of the x tilde of n. You repeat it in such a way that this linear convolution becomes a circular convolution. The reason why circular convolution is nice is FFT is very well behaved with circular convolution, okay, not linear convolution. Okay, so remember, cyclic prefix is a huge penalty. Okay, so you're sending some extra symbols for which you're wasting some time and power. Okay, maybe not bandwidth, but you're wasting both time and power. Those symbols need not really be transmitted, right, if you can decode them in the receiver, but they simplify your receiver drastically. Essentially, you have the same receiver whether or not you have ISI. The exact same receiver will work. Okay, so that's the basic advantage. Okay, so how do you do that? Let me just quickly go through that picture, and then we'll see how it works. Okay, so this is what you do. You have S of 0 to S of n minus 1. You're doing a, see, your transmission has to change. Remember, it's not just a reception. You do an IFFT. Okay, you get x tilde 0 to x tilde n minus 1. Okay, and then you have to add cyclic prefix. Okay, so this box becomes slightly bigger. Okay, what you do is you keep this part unchanged. You send x tilde of 0 to x tilde n minus 1. So in the previous l minus 1 symbols, you add x tilde n minus l minus 1 all the way down to x tilde n minus 1. Okay, so this is a way you simulate circular convolution through the channel. Okay, and then you do a parallel to serial conversion. Then this goes through your channel HN. Then noise gets added, and you receive RF. Okay, So instead of simply sending x tilde of 0 to x tilde of n minus 1, you take the last l minus 1 from your x tilde and then put it before this block. And this has the effect of simulating circular convolution from where to where? From, yeah, only from the received values corresponding to x tilde of 0 to x tilde of n minus 1. The previous things and all won't be circular convolution. It will be something else with something else which is different. Okay. But from the received values corresponding to x tilde of 0 to x tilde of n minus 1, you will be doing circular convolution. And so what you do with the receiver is you throw away everything else, only keep the circular convolution part, and then happily repeat your FFT, and you'll see that has a simplifying effect. Okay, I want to show you how that works. Okay, so if you do that transmission, remember what is your R of n? It is summation m equals 0 to l minus 1 hm x tilde n minus m plus noise, right? Okay, so if I were to write down the vector r, which is, okay, so now the vector r, I have to be very careful, the vector r will have a lot of coordinates. You will have I have to be careful where I start with 0. Okay, so I'm going to start with 0 corresponding to x tilde of 0. So let me write down x tilde also. So the x tilde vector is going to be written as x tilde n minus l plus 1, so on till x tilde n minus 1, then x tilde 0, so on till x tilde n minus 1. This is my transmission for x tilde. The received values corresponding to these things I'm going to start with r tilde 0 here, and this is going to become r tilde of minus 1 for me. Okay, so this will be r tilde of minus l plus 1. This is r tilde of 0 to r tilde of n minus 1. Okay, so this is how I'm going to write my received value r. You'll have more because you're transmitting more, but I'm going to only concentrate on this part. So this is my new vector r. So I want to write r tilde of 0 all the way down to r tilde of n minus 1 in terms of some matrix here times x tilde of 0 to x tilde of n minus 1. It turns out you will have a what's called a circulant matrix here. Okay, so we'll do this in the next class, but I just want to get you thinking about it. Try to fill out this matrix. You'll have a circulant matrix which actually corresponds to a circular convolution between the column of the circulant matrix and the x tilde of 0 to x tilde of n minus 1, and that is some nothing but, if you take FFT now, it will be FFT of that column times the FFT of x tilde, and that will give you a very simple equalization which cannot be done in serial PIM or anything like that. Okay, so we'll stop here for now. I'll continue from here in the next class.